Welcome back to Open Line. Talking about a bill in the legislature that would change the way some prescription drugs are packaged. Both of the people up here right now will be testifying on behalf of that bill in front of the legislature tomorrow. Dr. Sterling Herring from Vanderbilt and Liz Beatty, whose son died of an overdose. Both will be testifying tomorrow. We have several calls. Let's go to the phones. Let's go to Ricky. Hello, Ricky.
Hey, how you doing?
Doing well. What's on your mind? Go right ahead.
Well, what's on my mind? I've been on opium for like 10 years now. And a lot of times I think the people is missing the mark. You're talking about the cancer. I understand that about the kids. Like I went to a doctor for toothache. And they say, I know you write me a prescription for opiates. Never explained it to me. After my toothache is gone, guess what? I'm addicted to the opium. And the opium is hurting me more than the toothache was hurting me. I believe it's all about the money, and the people knew exactly what they was doing to get all these people addicted. Then they put it on us like we the problem. Like, respect to a young lady, she said, I believe she said her son bought it off the street. And if you buy something off the street, you know it's illegal. There's no telling what may happen. You buy some street drug, but I got it from the professional doctor, and I've been hooked on this stuff ever since. The pain is gone. It's just the addiction now that I fight with. I got to take a pill to function each and every day, you know, for that. But I don't think the people really going at the people at the top who produce this demon.
All right, Ricky.
You know, to get our country in the fix we in.
Right. Ricky, I really appreciate your call. I agree with a lot of what Ricky's saying. Okay, he's saying he's addicted. He had a toothache, was given this stuff, and now he's addicted. And he said it's all about money. What he's saying, there's a much bigger picture here. What about that? What about what he's saying?
Absolutely true. This is a multifaceted problem. It's going to require a multifaceted solution. And there are a lot of things that have been done. There are a lot of things that are being done. FDA, as I mentioned earlier, is working on another round of things just this year to try to address this problem. But he brings up an excellent point. There are times when opioids are appropriate, and there are times when they're inappropriate. And he described a situation where they're inappropriate. When I worked in addiction medicine, one of my favorite patients was a lady whose ex-husband had broken her jaw. And she was ended up addicted to prescription pain medication. There are terrible stories about how people got here. What this bill does is try to address a different type of population. I think we need to attack each problem with the appropriate solution. And this addresses young people that are being exposed to opioids and becoming addicted without necessarily meaning to. As for Ricky and anyone else that might be out there dealing with addiction, I don't know if we can have somebody get their contact information. I'd love to reach out to them and put them in contact with people who can help them.
Okay, great. And yeah, what he's saying is he would like to turn off the spigot somewhat, that these drugs are just out there all over the place. These companies are making tons of money. What you're saying is the spigot's on. You said on the break how much of these pills are left over. So somebody gets a prescription, they often don't use all of them, and then they leave them in their home, and its children can obtain them. And that's how many are being introduced to this. But what percentage is left over?
So we know that about 9% of people who have prescription opioids keep them in a locked place. Of people who have a prescription opioid and are in a home with children or teenagers, that number rises to about 12%. We also know that people who are prescribed opioids, around 57 to 60%, either have leftovers or anticipate having leftovers. 60%. So that points to a couple different problems. One, it means we're prescribing too much. We need to prescribe fewer opioids. We need to prescribe them appropriately when it's appropriate, but we need to refrain from prescribing either opioids or as many opioids when we can. Second, it means we have bottles of opioids that are out there for who knows how long, and we need to make a safer way of storing them. We need to keep people like Liz's son away from their primary exposures.
Okay, all right, very good. Let's go to Daniel. Hello, Daniel. Daniel, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
All right, go right ahead. What's on your mind?
Well, I think the lock on the bottle is the combination lock on the bottle. I mean, that's just a waste of money. I mean, if you want to get into the problem, it's like a forbidden fruit. You put a lock on it, kids are going to want it that much more. They're going to be like, oh, what's in there? I mean, that must be something really important. That's going to catch their eye the second they see it. Drug addict sees a bottle of dope, they don't take one or two out of the bottle. They take the whole bottle, and then they deny it and say, oh, I didn't see no bottle. I didn't get no bottle. I've been on pain pills for 20 years. I hate the things. They've destroyed my life. But that being said, I've tried to get in rehab. You want to put some money in something, put it in rehabs and actually being able to get into rehabs. I've called rehabs for the last 3 years. Oh, we got a six-week waiting list. We can put you, we can have a consultation 6 weeks. I could be dead from OD in 6 weeks. It's just, it drives me crazy. It's never going to change because pharmaceutical companies are the biggest political contributors out there. And that's why they're the biggest political contributors out there, because it's a billion-dollar industry. Not ever going to change. All these doctors are getting kickbacks. Pharmaceutical companies come in there and they say, hey, you know what? Write out so many of these pain pills a month, we're going to send you and your wife to Hawaii. Hey, we're going to give you a $20,000 bonus. That's what's going on. You ain't never going to get these pain pills off the street. I mean, even the police, I mean, they're busting down on people, selling their pain pills, and all that's doing is switching all these people to heroin because they can get it cheaper and it's easier accessible. And these people are dying over heroin because they don't know what they're putting in their body.
All right. Thank you, Daniel. I appreciate that call. I mean, boy, we've had two calls of people that say they're addicted. Just point out, point blank, addicted. And they're frustrated and feel like enough hasn't been done. I guess I'll let you take this call.
Well, I was going to say, I believe that it is easy to blame Big Pharma. A lot of the situation started with that. But you've got a lot of other players in here. I would point to insurance companies. For insurance companies, it is so much cheaper for them to approve by having pain medicine than it is to look for alternative types of treatment, whether it's acupuncture, whether it's physical therapy, whether it's using some type of, I believe now they're saying ibuprofen and Tylenol may be in some situations much better than Oxycontin. But it's as long as it's cheaper to have a prescription or not pay for treatment. With Alex, he went to treatment 3 different times. We went to outpatient, we went to a 30-day, we went to a 7-week wilderness. But what we're finding out with the brain studies is it takes up to 2 years for the brain to rewire. What's happening in addiction in a teenager, and this is what we're really dealing with, a teenager is a brain under construction. So imagine in a neighborhood you have a fully bricked home, full roof, and next to it you have just the framework going up. A straight line wind comes through that neighborhood. The brick home may have a little bit of damage. The framework is going to be completely gone. And so that's what's happening. The addiction is getting planted almost like a time bomb. It's a ticking time bomb in their brains. And the earlier it gets in there, the harder it is to get out. And I saw, like I said, with Alex, with alcohol and marijuana, he could come away from it. But the addiction to the opioids, the Xanax, is a much stronger. And so we're trying to address not getting on the conveyor belt. If we could just stop the number of ones entering it, we wouldn't be having the billions of dollars that we're spending on treatment, incarceration, lost productivity. So I agree with him. Yes, the full-blown addict will take it, but we're trying to address the person that hasn't yet gone that far.
Right. Just experimenting for the first time, or that initial sort of use without their parents knowing. And so many people get into these drugs that way. Your son went to a treatment program for how long? It was a wilderness treatment program.
He went to 7 weeks in northern Georgia, and he came out, and within 48 hours, he was drunk. And what I've learned since then is you can dry them out, and that's that first 100 days, that is just all you're doing, is just ridding the body of the actual chemicals. But their brain, it's almost like a possession. It is in there, it's telling them, no, you still need this. And you put them back in the community, especially young people, you're putting them back into high schools, back into the same neighborhoods where they lived, and they're around the same crowd and the same stressors, and they're going to go back. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when.
Both of these callers have talked about the money behind these pills. you all are going to be testifying tomorrow in the legislature. Who is opposed to what you're proposing here? What do you expect tomorrow?
I think there's a possibility of a number of people. Obviously, the pharmaceutical companies, we're learning more and more with ongoing court cases that we're hearing about in the news. The Sackler family is currently under a lot of investigation for their role in exactly what our last caller was talking about, profiting specifically and purposefully profiting off of addiction and death. I anticipate that they might oppose this bill. I think that anytime you're introducing a new solution to a problem, there are people who are going to be on the ground where the rubber hits the road, and some of those people might get a little upset at their new role in this. Maybe they didn't ask for this. I know that as a physician myself, our workflow has changed quite a bit over the past several years in terms of, you know, patients with legitimate opioid prescriptions, people who come in after having a massive car crash and they've got several bones broken and they need a short dose of an opioid medication to help get them past broken femurs and all these other terrible, terrible problems. But in order to do that, we have had to jump through an increasing number of hoops to prescribe those things. That is something that certainly lengthens our day, lengthens our workflow, but I think we all recognize the importance of it. Some, in this particular case, a portion of this workflow is gonna fall to pharmacists, and I anticipate that some of them may be frustrated by the changes to the workflow. I'm confident that the vast majority of pharmacists locally, across the state and nationwide, would be happy to play their part in this solution.
Are there other states that do this? Is this going on in other places?
This is a relatively new concept. It's something that is being entertained and considered in other states, but this is not something that has been fully rolled out in other states quite yet. We would not be an experiment. This is not a guinea pig situation. This is a leadership situation. And this would not be the first time that Tennessee has taken the lead on a major issue. Booster seats in cars, for example, not the little baby seats, but the booster seats that have been shown to reduce serious morbidity and mortality by 40%. Tennessee was the first state to introduce those here. So, and now all 50 states have a law requiring booster seats.
For this, you have Republican sponsors from East Tennessee, is that
yes.
right? Where this epidemic is really, really bad out there. So you do have Republican sponsors. All right, we have to take a break. But that's quite interesting. If you're on the line, hold on. Milton, Cheryl, Teresa, others. If you want to call in, there's the number, 615-737-PLUS. 615-737-7587. Take a break. Be back right after this.